Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Welcome to the moon. I'm your host for this evening, Lawrence Ray. And today I'm joined by my esteemed co-hosts, Ricardo Martinez and Jerry, as per usual. But today we are interviewing the wonderful Brandon Quittem, entrepreneur, writer, a speaker and a builder of Swan Bitcoin. I hope that was a good enough, very brief introduction of you there. But feel free to say hello and introduce yourself properly if you'd like.
Yeah, sure. Thanks for having me on, Lawrence, Jerry, Ricardo, the whole squad here. That's generally who I am. I consider myself a thinker, kind of like on the fringe of society, trying to kind of explore new and weird things, try to synthesize them and, produce cultural artifacts for the rest of the species. In Bitcoin land, first bumped into it in like Silk Road era, like 2011, 2012, 2013-ish. Friends were buying drugs on the internet. Holy shit, what is this thing? How is that possible? I never bought any then. I didn't think of it as an investment in any reason or any way. 2017 came around, numbers going up, pulled me in like many people, and then came for the gains and then realized, wow, this is fascinating. This is going to change the world. And I sort of changed my whole life around that at that point. Prior, I spent time in enterprise software sales at Oracle. So working with big accounts on software. Then I went and did some entrepreneurial stuff for about 5 years, building online companies. And then when I bumped into Bitcoin, I essentially realized that this is the new path and slowly sold off all those online businesses. And then did a bunch of everything to finally break into the industry and ended up at Swan about a year and a half ago, a little more now, end of 2019. And then I've been building Swan ever since. And if you don't know what Swan is, it's just an easy way to buy Bitcoin. Growing fast, focus on education, Bitcoin only. Our core product is an automatic recurring purchase plan, buy $50 a week or whatever your plan is, and then we automate everything for you. That's a mouthful. Back to you.
No, I appreciate it. Thanks. You answered a few of my questions already, which is great. So I already diced a few of those out of the way. And I'm keen to ask you some bits about Swan, but I guess before I do so, just want to kind of get into your brain a little bit. As to the whys and the hows kind of thing. So I guess when it comes to Bitcoin, you've already said how you discovered it, etc. I guess what interests me is you said you obviously had these businesses, you kind of just sold that off Bitcoin, and then you made this attempt essentially to move your life into the Bitcoin sphere. What was it about Bitcoin that kind of spoke to you, I suppose? What made you think, okay, this is what I need to do professionally, as well as put my funds into it and things like that?
Yeah, definitely. I could answer this so many different ways, but I think the actual reason, the primary reason, the stickiness that made me want to change everything has to do with the political implications of what a Bitcoin system represents. So prior to Bitcoin, I would consider myself left-leaning on the political spectrum, cared a lot about changing the world. I'm a big picture thinker. That's how I like to think about the world primarily. And I saw all these problems, and those problems were not being solved. And I was trying to figure out how to fix those problems. I was literally making phone calls for politicians, doing everything I could, wasting a lot of political energy trying to fix the system from the inside. And what Bitcoin, what it came to become for me was a parallel system, a way to address the root cause of these problems by building a new system rather than trying to fix the old system. And once those things clicked into place, I was like, great, I can maintain the path I'm on, but I can actually have a little hope or a little optimism about that this work that I'm doing in the world might actually pay off. And so it's kind of like a dead end into seeing a tunnel of opportunity. That's probably the best way to describe it. From other reasons, Bitcoin really clicked when I realized that it couldn't be stopped. I think that's probably the most important realization that most Bitcoiners go through. It's like, okay, sure, if you agree with the economics or you agree with the technology or something, fine. But if it is what we say it is, the state is going to squash it, right? I think that's a pretty rational point to get to. And so kind of systematically thinking about it, how is it going to die, or how could it die, and how Bitcoin can survive all those attacks, that really cemented it in my mind. If it can't die, then this thing's going forever. And of course, tied into a living organism, which I'm sure we'll get to, that was another parallel thread here that gave me confidence.
I first came across your work actually because of your Bitcoin is the Mycelium of Money series of articles. I was looking on your blog and it seems like you've kind of condensed several articles into one. When I first read it, it was actually a series of articles. What was the most striking parallel between Bitcoin and neural networks and mycelial networks that inspired you to write that series of blog posts?
Yeah, definitely. And you're right, Ricardo. I wrote them all in series, part one, part two, part three, part four. And I posted them on Medium. And then I created my own website, brandonquittem.com. So I just merged them all together, smoothed out the transitions. And that's where I'd recommend reading them now. Forget outsourcing your content to a third party. What stood out to me the most? So I think the most compelling thing here is that starting with Bitcoin, if you look at this thing, it's kind of software, it's kind of hardware, it's kind of humans, it's kind of a blend of all these things, right? It's a techno-social system of some sorts. And it seems to adapt to its environment, it seems to learn, it seems to change over time. And so it's kind of hard to grasp, right? And depending on what way you look at it, you know, kind of look through a prism, your own experiences taint how you see Bitcoin or what parts stand out to you. And I have a long history of being just an amateur naturalist, meaning I like camping and fishing and foraging and gardening and just everything related to biology I love. And so, and totally as an amateur, by the way, I'm not a scientist. And so when I started evaluating Bitcoin, I think it was originally the Lightning Network graph, just seeing the topological map of the Lightning Network. And I was like, oh, weird, that kind of looks like a mycelial network. And then the hamster wheel started to go. And so I think the most salient point here is that, now tying into fungi, the primary archetype of a fungal organism is this mycelial network. It is like a decentralized brain. And you can think of it like an underground root system. They also live in trees and in other environments, but it's a series of tubes. It's straight up industrial infrastructure underground that ships resources and information through all the forests, all the ecosystems on our planet. It's pretty much everywhere. And it doesn't have a centralized decision-making point. There's no brain, there's no CPU. Instead, it's more like a combination of millions of individual fungal cells that share genetic information. And those fungal cells grow and branch off again in this little root structure. And they make decisions in their location, right? Do I go this way or do I go that way? Do I eat this? Do I run away? Whatever. And it's the sum total of all these individual units combined that ultimately makes the organism, right? And to give to kind of anthropomorphize here for a second, let's say there's an invader that comes and attacks this mycelial mat, which could be the size of like an apple, or it could be the size of a football field or the size of an entire forest, right? So the scale, it could be any different size. And if a predator comes on one side, starts attacking this mycelial network, information travels through the system. It reaches the quote mushroom scientists, and fungi are the best chemists on the planet. Most of our medicine comes from fungi. So it identifies a predator, sends information to the mushroom scientists. They create a custom molecule, a brand new enzyme to then go deal with that predator. Okay, then it ships that information over to the edge of the network, deals with the predator, and the system learns and adapts. And over time, it creates a chemical library of all these different molecules. And so again, it's adapting, it's learning. And I think the Bitcoin network is very similar, right? There's individuals, both on like the node enforcing the rules or the hardware, or just individuals like you and I. We all act in our own rational best interests based on how we see the world. And the sum total of all of us individually creates the network. And so I think that parallel is really nice. And if we want to anthropomorphize Bitcoin, what happens? Okay, we have a bug in the network, or there's an attack from a nation state or some other sort of attack. Information travels through Twitter and Telegram groups. It reaches the right people. Problems identified. Developers write some new code. They release a software patch or enzyme, ships it through the network, and deals with the attack, right? And so there's this decentralized brain, and that archetype just, it mirrors really well. Terence McKenna, a famous psychonaut, he also called mycelium the Wood Wide Web, right? And so that archetype's been going on for a long time, and I guess just putting those pieces together really started to make sense for me.
That's a crazy, like, cool. I didn't know, like, to that extent of how, like, mushrooms actually create new ways to basically defend against attacks. Or I didn't know it was that to that level, actually. That's really interesting. I knew about, like, the web, but I didn't know, like, to the degree of, like, intelligence, I guess, that has. So that's pretty cool. I guess, like, I'm trying to think, because we can draw this, like, similarity, and you're kind of right, between Bitcoin and mycelium is, like, because, as you said, there's obviously all these different tubes or nodes or whatever, and then information travels via whatever form, in person, internet, whatever it is. And then I guess what I suppose the learning from that could be, I'm trying to think of, like, of how that can be used to make the Bitcoin network better. I suppose, would it be that if there's, like, an attack, like a 51% attack, everyone finds out, and then we can essentially, I know I'm going off a little bit randomly, but I guess I'm trying to work out, like, because you've linked those two things together, and I'm trying to work out what the learning from nature can be for the Bitcoin network. You know what I mean? Like, in a way to make it better or something.
So I have a long list of those ideas, but the first one that comes to mind, pulling on your mycelial thread, excuse the lame pun. The big teaching here is that fungal organisms, or these decentralized network intelligence, that archetype, it's not just fungi. If you zoom in on neurons in our brain works the exact same way. It's a decentralized process that's constantly changing and evolving. And it's not like the hippocampus does one thing. It's like the hippocampus related to the this that's related to that, right? And so that's if you zoom in. If you zoom way out, you look at outer space, you look at the cosmos, it also forms the same decentralized network archetype. You look at a supercluster, right? And you look at dark energy and dark matter, it forms the same network archetype. And so it seems to persist, which gives credence to an idea if it shows up in multiple scales over and over again, right? It's almost as if it's an evolutionary strategy that seems to be effective. And if we bring it back to planet Earth, what we see is that fungal organisms are the longest standing complex life on our planet. Recent fossil records of over 1.3 billion years old were fungal fossils. And we've had about 5 mass extinction events on our planet that we know of, right? Think of 65 million years ago, asteroid hits killed some dinosaurs, things like that. And every time these cataclysmic events occur, what happens is all life on Earth goes through a massive transition, right? And in terms of the dinosaurs, we went from the age of reptiles to the age of mammals. Okay. And in that bottleneck of evolutionary history, what we see is that most life dies out. And what happens is fungi inherit the Earth. They temporarily take over the entire planet and they essentially rebuild. And why is that? Well, they're the most survival, the creatures that are most adapted to survive. They find their own food. So they're not reliant on sunlight like plants are. They also inhale oxygen and exhale carbon dioxide, similar to just like us, right? Opposite of plants. And they have this, like, ability to learn and reproduce in new novel ways and create new food sources, et cetera. And so I think the main lesson here is that these fungi are antifragile and they're built to survive. This decentralized archetype is hyper inefficient, but the inefficiency allows the adaptability and the survivability. And I think that's the main lesson of the mycelial network, is that decentralization is adaptive and resilient, but it's also inefficient. And those are the trade-offs you need in order to remove money from the power of the state, and take it one step further, remove the power of individual humans or small groups or any type of power structure from changing the rules. And I think that's what gives me confidence long-term, is that the system removes human greed, or I should say it removes the influence of human greed, right? Each of our individual greed makes the network stronger, but we cannot change the system. And so, yeah, antifragile, that's what comes up for me as number one.
I suppose, like, it goes to sort of show that I can't think of any centralized government or system that's actually managed to keep centralized power for longer than a century or something like that. Usually dynasties or whatever die out eventually, like something goes wrong with that centralized power, whether it's the person who was the most powerful died and blah, 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 blah. And I guess with money as well, as you kind of hinted on, It's like, I guess the only thing I think of is like, obviously, if you're relying on gold with like gold backed currencies, which is like gold's from nature, right? The day, I suppose, then that's usually when you saw good periods of growth. And then as soon as governments took things into their own hands in like the early 1900s, then that's when, like, inevitably there's always going to be some kind of greed or some kind of, oh, well, we can just do this one thing here. That's like, and then boom, that's where the centralized side of it causes problems, is that someone, the main power source or the person in control is always going to, there's always gonna be something tainted at the end of the day at some point, because it's human nature. So I guess, yeah, as you say, like if you have more decentralized, well, decentralization is nature, I suppose, then really. So I guess the more decentralized most things are, generally, the more fair or the more elongated and the more something is going to survive, basically.
Yeah, exactly. I think there's an interesting parallel here between industrial farming, mass scale, hyper efficient farming, and nature, or let's say an old growth forest, right? So if we start with industrial farming or fiat food, the goal is to create as much food in as small a space for as cheap as humanly possible. So in order to do that, we essentially look at food like a manufacturing process, right? Inputs, outputs, decreased costs, et cetera. And that allows us to produce a shitload of food. Sorry, can we swear? I don't know. You let me know. All right. You can put a lot of food in a small amount of space, which is what we're doing with factory farming. But the problem is, what we're doing is we're essentially strip mining the soil. We're taking all the nutrients out. Right, it's a very high time preference activity. It took us about 2 billion years to create topsoil, and we're going to get rid of it all in 200 years. That's madness. And so, what you get with fiat food or industrial farming or the fiat monetary system is hyper efficiency, but very low resiliency. Right. And for example, there's this famous example of the banana. Okay. Way back when, I think it was in the 50s, there was one species of banana grown all around the world. Like 99% of all bananas were all clones of the exact same, like literally clones, the same exact genetics all over the world. And you do that for efficiency. And then a fungus realized, whoa, there's a lot of food here. A fungus learned how to consume that banana, evolved, and now started attacking it. And then in the course of like 2 years, the entire banana crop on the planet died. Right, that's the risk. That's the anti-fragility of these systems. And so then what did they do? Well, we came up with a new banana. We didn't learn. Now we have the Cavendish banana, our current primary banana you see in the grocery store. We didn't learn. Same deal. And guess what? It's being attacked by fungus. We're going to get a new banana. To circle back to something more relevant, now let's talk about a old growth forest or Bitcoin. Right? These are emergent systems. These grow step by step. It's fierce competition. No plant is there because we planted it, right? The plant is there because it outcompeted its neighbor. And so it's a biodiverse system. It's resilient to weather changes because there's lots of different organisms, each with their own strategy. And that's a slower growing, less yield per acre. However, weather changes, predators, doesn't matter. It's going to last forever. And that's kind of how Bitcoin's built. Right, it's way more efficient to use a Visa-like system where I have a single node. But with Bitcoin, right, we have multiple nodes. We have cheap validating hardware. We have a rough consensus. We have all these things that are inefficient, and yet that inefficiency is what provides the resiliency. And if we look at now just at the financial system in general, the fiat system, you mentioned things like man can only control power structure or a monetary system for like 100 years, even less usually, right? And why is that? Well, man can't help themselves, whether we get greedy or we see the housing market crash, and the options are let the market fail or bail everyone out, right? If we allow humans to make a decision, we're always going to think short term, we're going to bail people out, right? If we're going to vote on it, that's what people are going to do. It's rational. And so that leads to a series of systemic hiding of risk, right? We kick the can down the road. We don't let the market clear. And instead, we're suppressing all this volatility. Just stick it under the mattress. And eventually, it becomes so big that, let's say, in 2008-09 financial crisis, a small problem, mortgage-backed securities, one Jenga block is pulled and the whole system collapses. And that would never happen if you allowed the market to clear initially. And so that's kind of like the fiat food, fiat money, industrial farming, whatever, versus Bitcoin system, which, you know, it's going to let the market clear. It's going to smooth out the volatility. It's going to smooth out the business cycle. And there will not be zombie corporations propped up by cheap money. The market's going to clear and the capital is going to recycle. And I think now one caveat here is the transition from fiat monetary system to a more free market monetary system. That's Bitcoin. No clue how that's going to go. Probably messy. But if we could just clear slate, wipe it clean, and I think that will happen eventually. I think a Bitcoin system will be better for humans, and it's going to be a much more long-term approach to building. Rather than start over every 30, 50, 100 years, we can build a new, steady, solid foundation that is Bitcoin. And that'll allow us as a civilization to grow much higher, do much more interesting things.
You mentioned Stamets as a psychonaut, and you mentioned the Silk Road. What are the overlaps that you perceive between Bitcoin and psychedelics?
Good question, Ricardo. Many. Let's see, I'll ramble through a few. So number one, I just for some very scientific data, I tweeted out like a year ago saying, hey, Bitcoiners, are you supportive of psychedelics? Yes or no? Some poll like that. And it was like 79% of people who responded to my poll said that they support psychedelics. And so I think it's probably like 3 to 5 times more than the national average in the US, just to give rough estimate, which would indicate that Bitcoiners are very open-minded to psychedelics compared to normal people. Unsurprising. Okay, what do psychedelics do, or why would someone be drawn to them? Number one, culture says they're bad. So you have to be kind of disagreeable with culture in order to say yes to psychedelics, just like you have to be disagreeable to say yes to Bitcoin, especially in the early day. So disagreeableness seems obvious. They also deal with opening your mind. And I don't mean that in like a woo-woo way. I mean that like literally trait openness, which is one of the big five personality traits from psychology, is openness. And we can demonstrate now in a lab showing that people who use psychedelics increase trait openness. So they're more open-minded. And I think that also correlates with Bitcoin, because in order to grasp what this thing is, you have to kind of throw away your preconceived notions of what money is. And you have to humble yourself and realize that it's a hard, harsh process to learn and unlearn all these things in order to accept Bitcoin. And so I think those are two right off the top. I think there's something else about, like, how can I say this? Like, psychedelics are something that make you a better person, and they allow you to find rock bottom truth in the world. And yes, it can be a party drug and all this other nonsense, but at the core, what they do is they strip away cultural programming. You go to the rock bottom of who you are, and you have an ability to be a better person. And I think the type of people who pursue psychedelics are seeking truth. Many of them are, myself included. And I think that's the same with Bitcoin. It's like, once you get a taste of truth or inching closer to truth, you want more of it. And so I think what you see with Bitcoiners is that if you find Bitcoin, you realize on the path to understanding Bitcoin, you realize that the government's perspective on money is not the whole story. And if that's true, we've been lied to, quote unquote, our whole lives about money, then what else might not be true? What else are we lied about, right? So it leads to this series of asking questions. And so to summarize, it both self-selects, Bitcoin self-selects for people who are open-minded, and people who take psychedelics are more inclined to find Bitcoin. So it's both. And one last little nugget here that's kind of fun is that a extremely high percentage of high-profile Bitcoiners, people you guys know by first name, have privately and publicly told me that they're supportive or they've consumed psychedelics and it has positively impacted their life and positively impacted their perspective on Bitcoin. Like, I learned a lot about Bitcoin while tripping. Like, that is a very common response. And most Bitcoiners are shy about it because, whatever, there's still some cultural baggage that comes along with it. But I encourage people to come out of the psychedelic closet. It's changing fast. And the more healthy, good, normal people being pro-psychedelics, I think that's better. It'll move the needle quicker. just like being open about Bitcoin. You need the NIMs, but you also need the public people putting their reputation on the line saying, I'm a normal person, I support Bitcoin, I support psychedelics, and so should you.
There's a lot of nuggets there, like quite a few things that I can think of to ask you or talk about. I guess like as you say, I kind of see actually the people I've met in person in my life or stumbled upon in person who are into Bitcoin were also into psychedelics quite a lot and spoke about how it changed their points of view. Something I've never tried myself, but would probably be open to in the future. But yeah, I think that like one of the things you draw on a little bit as well, which I guess I find quite interesting, is like how essentially, you know, the swap from the current fiat system to Bitcoin system, and obviously as well trying to get rid of what you understand or we understand money is right now. And I think something that's weird to me is I was thinking literally this earlier today, was that if you went up to someone from like 1840 or something, and if you can get past the hurdle of explaining the technology, right, of like Bitcoin, the internet, that bit, right, if you can somehow just give them that knowledge, they would be so much more accepting probably of Bitcoin than probably anyone in the last century immediately off the bat, I would have thought, because they're like, well, yeah, okay, it's limited. It's like, there's a limited supply. It's something that like is essentially sound, it's sound money, like gold would be, for example. So I'm thinking like, it's kind of something we've been trained with the whole sort of Keynesian approach of the last 100 years, maybe, to kind of think in this wrong manner. So it's almost like you've got to untrain. Yeah, I mean, I feel like we always think of history in such like a short view, like over the last 20 years or whatever, but actually look at the last 20,000 years, probably our forefathers would have understood it a lot better than we do immediately when you start teaching us about it.
100%. I think it depends where in history you go, right? I think your last point about the forefathers, I think that's the most important point. But before we go there, I guess when I look throughout monetary history, I see periods of hard money, I see periods of soft money, right? And so it kind of flows in and out. And most people, how would I say this? Like, we have a recency bias, and the lesson of history is that we don't learn from history. And so we all kind of feel like we're in our tight little band, we're all fish swimming in the water and we don't know we're wet, right? And so depending on where you look, if you're on the back end of a hyperinflation event, it's extremely obvious why you need Bitcoin. But if you're in the middle of the Roman Empire's growth period, primarily built on sound money and trade and accounting, you wouldn't even know you needed it, right? You would probably take for granted the fact that the money was important. And so I kind of go back and forth with your point, but I guess I wanted to zero in on our founding fathers. And I'm from America. We have people from all over the world in this call, so it's not relevant exactly to everyone. However, the ideas of America, property rights, separation of church and state, federalism, right, distributing power, these type of ideals are very powerful. They're very, very aligned with Bitcoin. And so our founding fathers absolutely would have understood the value of Bitcoin. And it's really sad when you see, we'll say the populist political left in the United States, which finds socialism popular. We call each other, this group calls each other comrade, unironically. And again, back to the point of they don't know how important sound money is because they were given everything and they're wondering why it's not going well. And so, yeah, it's honestly a very frustrating point watching young people think that socialism is the problem here, or sorry, is the solution here. But to empathize with that group a little bit, they see a world with no hope. They don't trust the politicians. They have no money. They can't save. They can't get ahead. And so the average young person today feels left out and they feel screwed. And rightfully so. They legitimately are. But sadly, it's not as easy as just saying, well, capitalism is the enemy. We just have to give socialism, right? And so the political narrative is rich people are evil, so we need to steal their money and give it to the poor people, and then everything will be fine. Right. And that totally betrays economic reality. And so I'm a little bit scared of the populist left, predominantly young people, trying to attack free markets, trying to attack Bitcoin, trying to attack what we call capitalism, because that's, you diagnose the problem, right? But the solution is incorrect. And so I would love to see capture the hearts and minds of young people more. because they are the future and they're the ones who need hope. And the reality is that Bitcoin fits into their worldview a lot more than they think it does. But I think that mainstream narrative around Bitcoin is more like a libertarian wet dream than it is like, hey, this is honest money. This is the most fair system we can possibly create, right? And it's just about framing, but I'd like to see the young people on board quicker because I think they need it.
Well, something that I don't know. Did you watch the B Word conference? Very topical, actually. It happened yesterday as of the time of recording. but yeah, I saw a bit of it live. Honestly, got bored. And then I watched a highlight later on, just of like different bits. The only thing that I actually did find really a good point, actually, from Elon Musk, someone I'm not massively a fan of by any means, but a good point that he made was when someone was, I can't remember who set this up, and I can't even remember his direct quote, but he basically said that, well, it's like, if you don't like business, government essentially is the business at the very worst and the very largest, and they essentially uses violence. And so I found that was like a pretty good point, because like, if you look at Bitcoin specifically as well, right, you've got this kind of sound, fair money, essentially. And if you look at sort of the government as the largest business, and you look at things like Amazon and Apple and all these large corporations underneath it, it's kind of like the government obviously benefits the most from the current fiat system, and then the large companies beneath them benefit a hell of a lot as well, and that essentially just cascades down so that small businesses and really, really local people with their one sort of mom and pop store size coffee shop or whatever get completely screwed. And what I feel like with Bitcoin is it's almost like it's kind of giving people a chance, right? Like, if you have this little mom and pop store, if you accept Bitcoin, if you try and like just try and do something different to bring in customers, and then you can essentially, the more of you who do that, it's kind of like a vote against like these large corporations and the large government and the financial system that they're using that isn't working, essentially. So it's kind of like I guess what I'm trying to get is like, it kind of works for business as well as just individuals. Like, if you're for small businesses, like Bitcoin is almost like, to me anyway, I feel like kind of a savior. And if someone out there can, you know, develop like an application or something that can kind of empower small businesses to start accepting Bitcoin and bring in a ton of users that way, then onto something pretty good.
Yeah, I agree. And I think your point there is very, very important, right? I think Elon's quote was like, if you don't like big corporations, you should hate the government even more, or something like that. And that's a really, really, really quote-based perspective from Elon Musk. And I guess my takeaway from the conference or from that specific talk was that Elon is going slow, step by step. He's learning. He still doesn't know very much. Like, I know 19-year-olds in Nigeria that could school him on all things Bitcoin. So he's got a lot of room to grow there. But he did say a lot of base things, and I think he's inching in Bitcoin's direction. I don't want to support him, but I think generally speaking, the message is going to be positive coming out of that conference to the broader audience that may have listened to that. And with regards to the current system and how corporations, politicians, the whatever, they have more benefits than the little guy, that's true, right? It was called the Cantillon effect from an economist who recognized the closer you are to the money printer, the more benefits you have. And that's absolutely true. We essentially have a system where the source of the money printer is so powerful that incentivizes anyone who can get close to it to do so. So that's corporations, that's literally the government, right? The government can print money or they can tax you. Those are the two forms of revenue. Nobody likes taxes. So if you're going to take my money out of my paycheck, you better give me a good reason to say yes to that, right? So it's actually an honest trade, saying, here's your tax bill, this is what we're going to give you for it. Whereas inflation is like a shadow tax. They can print as much as they want, do whatever they want with it. And it's not immediately obvious to normal people that they're stealing from you. And so it's kind of a shadow tax or an overt thing. And that sucks, right? And so the incentives there are to politicize the money. And that leaves the people who don't have political capital left out in the dark. And that's why you see the large businesses going to government and changing the rules to prevent the little startups from being able to compete, right? The regulatory capture angle. And so all these incentives just build a structure that steals from the little guy and puts at the top of the pyramid over and over and over again. And Bitcoin threatens that game. And if Bitcoin is successful, and I would argue it's on its way, it's going to depoliticize the money. It's going to change the incentives completely, because if you can't change the system, if you don't get unfair rules in Bitcoin, right? Nobody has unfair rules in Bitcoin. Everyone's treated the same. If that's true, then the incentive is not to attack the money. The incentive is to actually create value. And how different of a world would it be if politicians are only able to raise funds through taxes and corporations only make money by creating value, right? Like that's a much more, that's a better world, right? At least everyone has a chance. And if we go global for a second, I have a tendency to think in my own backyard more than global, right? I live in America, and this is the water I'm in, whatever. But the reality is that I benefit more from the Cantillon effect than someone from El Salvador, for example, right? I can get a stimulus check. People in El Salvador, we're just exporting our inflation to them and they get no benefit from it. And simultaneously, it's very expensive under our current banking system to bank the bottom third of our planet, right? We have these rules like KYC, and you have to have an address and do all these things. And so the bottom third of our planet can't get bank accounts. So zero access to financial services. And in a modern global digital world, we're essentially one third of the human capital can't compete in the marketplace. So not only is that a humanitarian nightmare, but it's also bad for the whole population, right? I believe that markets surface the best ideas, and a good idea, let's say a mobile phone, starts off expensive for the wealthy and then it becomes something for the whole world, right? And so we want everyone we can possibly get competing in the market to bring their ideas to market, because the few ideas that are really good and they become commercialized help everyone. And so Bitcoin not only onboards human capital and it's good for those individuals, but it's actually good for our species. And so I see Bitcoin as an imperative in modern times. And speaking the same economic language, to use a metaphor, honestly, it's hard for me to comprehend how much value will unlock, right? How many Leonardo da Vinci's, how many Maya Angelou's, how many insert famous inventor creator are hiding in countries right now, and they can't get their ideas off the ground. They can't save. They can't get ahead. They're farming and they're just trying to get by because they can't get a loan to start a business. So they can't form capital to start their business. Right? It's tragic, honestly. And so we got to make this thing work.
Brandon, one of the most discussed was your idea of Bitcoin and the fourth turning. Would you mind kind of giving us a summary of what that is?
Yeah, totally. So everyone knows the sovereign individual, a book kind of looking at mega trends throughout history. It's a very common Bitcoin book. It sort of predicted, Bitcoin, it predicted like fracturing of city states, all these things. And I bring it up because it was written in the same year as the fourth turning. So it's a late 90s book written by demographers, and it similarly is prophetic and looking to the future, and it seems to be getting a lot of things right. What they're looking at here is that human time, we view as a linear thing, right? Left to right, A to B, month to month, year to year, whatever. However, they look at time in a more cyclical fashion, which is how ancient man used to look at time. And what they're finding is that if you look at demographics, so you're looking at people and demographic cohorts and how those demographics move through time, what they're finding is that patterns start to emerge. Okay. And the primary pattern that they see is a roughly an 80 to 90 year cycle, which they call a saeculum, which is essentially a long human life. And in that 80 to 90 year cycle, they go through four stages: first, second, third, fourth turnings. Each cycle, each part of the cycle is called a turning, spring, summer, winter, fall, or however you want to look at it. And at the end of that cycle, we have this external world crisis. So think like we build all these institutions like government, politics, and business, and schools, and whatever. And at the end of the cycle, we essentially outgrow those institutions and they start to decay for whatever reason. And we realize, wow, our institutions suck. It's time to destroy them and start over. And so they observed this cycle, and we're at right now, we're like right in the middle of the fourth turning. And to go back in history a little bit, this current fourth turning started right after World War II, or sorry, this cycle started after World War II. So around like 1945, 1946. And so the previous fourth turning was 1929 to 1945. Okay, that's the stock market crash, that's the Great Depression, that's World War II, that's Keynesianism, where we started to monetize the debt, that's where we invented the World Bank, IMF, Social Security, all kinds of crazy things changed in that period. And so there's a fourth turning, and then we go into Pax Americana, 1945 to like the mid 60s. That's when typical first turning, everyone's sick of fighting, and it's just like cooperation. Culture is boring, it's sterile. Things are pretty good, right? And then you have the Cultural Revolution, the second turning. That's when all of the kids who grew up in this leave it to beaver, white picket fence, sterile, boring world, they grow up and they go, screw that. Where's the music? Where's the edge? Where's the sex, drugs, and rock and roll? That's the second turning. That's a cultural revolution. That's an internal revolution where the oppressed, boring kids rebel against their parents, and then you get civil rights movements, you get the psychedelic 60s, et cetera. And then that transitions into a third turning. That's 80s and 90s. The parallel here would be like the 1920s, the flappers, it's just like deregulation, culture is successful, and we start just partying, and like it's something feels off, but nobody cares. It's like the getting's still good, so let's get drunk before the booze runs out. And then you have 08, right? And that's the transition to the fourth turning. So that'd be like 1929 and 08. 2008 are kind of the same time period. And what that is the recognition that our institutions are failing and that we actually need our institutions. And so that would be, okay, aftermath of the great financial crisis, you look around, you say, okay, the financial system is broken. It'd be really good if that was working. Oh, weird, the media can't be trusted. Okay, healthcare is garbage in the United States and most places. You know, the politics isn't working for people. And you start to see our entire exterior world's not working and the people are revolting against it. And so what happens is in fourth turnings, the people collectivize and they decide it's time to make a change. And sometimes that goes really dark. Like in the 30s, there was a lot of talk of communism and collectivism. Marginal tax rates got up like 79% or something like that. And essentially, it's humanity's response to a huge problem. The response is to collectivize and work together. And so that's what's happening right now. I would argue that things like cancel culture, that would be a symptom of the humanity's collective understanding that shit's messed up and we need to figure it out. And the response is, if you're not with us, you're against us. So it creates this rigid cultural lines. And if you're outside the circle, you get canceled. And that's kind of where we are right now. And the tricky part here is, I would say we have somewhere between 5 to 10 years left of this fourth turning. And every fourth turning has a climax period. That would be World War II previously. And all previous fourth turnings in the United States have been war. So World War II, the American Revolution, or sorry, the Civil War, and then the American Revolution going back. And so the previous three fourth turnings have been war. The question is, what will our conflict be for this fourth turning? I really hope it's not total war. It could be. It could be COVID. It could be American Civil War. It could be something else. I don't know. But my feeling is that we haven't reached the peak of the climax yet. And so I'm looking to the future. I see risk on the horizon. So in my personal life, I'm trying to think about ways to prevent catastrophic risk. Right? Own some Bitcoin, get a second passport, have a backup plan, have a side hustle, whatever the things are that you can do in your life to decrease the risk of ruin, I think makes sense in a period of high volatility. The last thing I'll say is that if this thesis feels weird, whatever, like read the first like 10 minutes of the article I wrote. It explains the thesis a little bit more in depth. But the thing that really made sense to me was there's a symbiosis between the context upon which we live, so our environment, and how we respond to it. So for example, the millennial generation, we're all born at the same time period, roughly. So if you're born in the same context, the culture around you shapes everyone the same, right? It doesn't mean we're all equal, we're all whatever, but we all have the same influences. So generally speaking, the millennial generation who grew up in a set period of time is more alike than, let's say, the Gen Xers who grew up in an entirely different cultural context, right? So culture influences the generation. Then that generation, which is relatively well-defined, grows up. Again, they're all similar. And then they start pushing back on culture. And then that culture produces the next generation. And then they grow up and then they start influencing culture. So it's a symbiotic relationship between culture and generations. And that is the fundamental building block of these cycles. And then you layer in the fact that humans act in a predictable way. Young people grow up and they rebel against their parents. Middle-aged people, they start families, they become more conservative, they take less risk. Older people act a certain way, right? So stages of life matter. And so it sounds like horoscopes for intellectuals. However, I think there's truth here, which is that this base emergent human thing, like we think we're these rational monkeys or whatever, but we act so predictively irrational.
I mean, I guess like from my perspective, I'd like to just be in the second cycle. That sounds pretty cool. Just, you know, rebelling, chilling out, having a good time. that's just sad that, you know, born in the wrong time, I guess. But I don't know, for preparation for the next potential war, I think like the least affected places in World War II, probably like South America potentially, right? Like generally unaffected. So I'm going to head over to South America, get some of my own land, get loads of Bitcoin and just chill out, have a good time. That's the, no, I know it's not that simple, but I guess, I want to keep going on this kind of conversation topic, but then I'm also keen to ask you about something a little bit different since we've probably not got too long left until we need to finish up. But I guess what I wanted to ask you about was like the Swan Bitcoin situation. So a few questions, which I'll kind of ask you in a mishmash. How did that happen? How did you end up doing that? and I guess why as well, like what was the opportunity that came to you? And then I suppose as well, like to understand like Swan Bitcoin, one thing I wanted to ask you, actually I'll save this next question. Just tell me the answer to those first ones. I think, yeah, it's probably best to go.
Yeah, so genesis there is I met Corey, the CEO of Swan, in San Francisco in 2019. Yeah, Bitcoin 2019, San Francisco in like June or something. We had a quick chat, formed a quick relationship. He told me about a company he's going to launch called Give Bitcoin, which was the original implementation of this product. And then a few months later, I was out in LA. Corey, I said, hey, Bitcoiners, I'm in LA, who wants to meet up? Corey reached out, we got lunch, and he sort of learned about my marketing experience and said, hey, will you help us set up an email marketing system for this product? Great. Help him do that. That turned into, okay, well, maybe you should do this for your job now. And that's just sort of, you know, partnership was obvious at that point, and it turned into a job. So that's how it started. Why did we start Swan? So the key here is that we wanted a Bitcoin-only exchange. We wanted to focus on automatic recurring purchases, right? Your $50 a week, your 10 bucks a day, your 1,000 a month, whatever your thing is. We want to build a product that's like that because there wasn't anything out there. And so we wanted to build a simple Bitcoin product. And the thesis was around education, because our belief is that the more you know, the more you buy. Pretty simple, pretty obvious. And so we're all in on education and community and trying to teach people pretty hardcore Bitcoin things that you're not going to get from a Coinbase or a Gemini or even a Cash App, right? And so, not that I'm against Cash App, or I'm friendly, I support Cash App, but I think we have a better product, their fee is half as much, and we're all in on Bitcoin and they're a little more distributed. So that's how we got there. It's grown really fast. Thankfully, the Bitcoiners have supported it. And now we kind of have two primary buckets in our business. We have the retail business, which is normal people buying Bitcoin. And then we have Swan Private, which is for high net worth individuals and or people who want to buy through a business entity. Maybe your company wants to put some of your treasury in Bitcoin. maybe you have a trust, maybe you have a IRA or some other tax advantage account and you want to move some Bitcoin there, or you just want to buy $1 million for the Bitcoin or whatever the number is. And so that's kind of like concierge, you get an account rep, you get all these fancy services. So that's the two sides of business. Maybe you had another question there. Let's
stop. No, I mean, like the follow-up question, I suppose, you explained like kind of like the why and how you found yourself there, which I was interested in. And I guess like the opportunity that like the Swan team saw, right, to come out with this idea and implementation. I suppose the other thing was like, hey, when it comes to what you guys are up to now, like, are you guys just US based now, or have you expanded further? Because I wasn't entirely certain. I know you're not in the UK, or at least if you are, please tell me. But I don't think you are. So like, how's that kind of side of things going?
Yeah, totally. So we initially launched in the US, and I would say that's still probably like 90% of our business or something like that. I could be wrong, but I think it's roughly around there. We do have international customers from 50 countries maybe at this point, but what we don't have is here's the deal. Banking systems in the US don't speak very nicely to banking systems somewhere else. You might have SEPA, or you might have insert banking system. And so what we do for international clients is we only accept wire transfers. And wire transfers, they speak the same language abroad, so it's easy to accept. And so if you're in the UK, you can wire us funds. It will clear same day or next day. And then you can do whatever you want with the funds once they're in your Swan account. And so it's primarily larger customers who do wires. Like, if you're buying $50 a week, you wouldn't want to spend $10-$20 on a wire transfer every week, right? But if you sold the business and you want to move 10,000, 100,000, 100 million over, that makes sense internationally. People ask, will you offer a DCA product in Europe or Canada in the future? We want to say yes, but there's so much opportunity in the United States that it doesn't seem likely, for sure not this year. I'd be shocked if we did this year. Probably not even next year, to be honest. But if Corey is listening, he might have a different perspective. So don't hold me to that.
I listened to you and just really appreciate everything you said. You know, it's a bit abstract, but you know, this is the first time I've had, you know, I've actually had an interview where, you know, you unpacked a lot and sort of had, you know, totally different, you know, perspective on, you know, Bitcoin and, you know, how it, you know, relates to human beings, you know, in a special kind of way. You spoke about, you know, Bitcoin anti, you know, fragility, and one of the things that makes or could make Bitcoin, you know, even more anti-fragile is privacy, you know, privacy in the sense that, you know, especially at the base layer. And I think that, you know, privacy at the base layer is going to be, you know, a bone of contention in the future, where, you know, we'd have people who think that, you know, adding, you know, privacy at the base layer, you know, might not sit down well with a bunch of people, especially the people in suits, like the mycelium of the industry who would want, you know, Bitcoin adoption at the more corporate level. So, and I tend to agree with that, you know, perspective. Do you think Bitcoin privacy at the base layer could affect the adoption of Bitcoin, or to limit Bitcoin, the potentials in terms of adoption and on a global scale? And do you think, if that's the case, do you think it's a compromise that we could make? Or do you think, because I do not see Bitcoin replacing the, you know, fiat system as the way it is currently without, you know, some sort of compromise, because I do not see government, you know, in accepting Bitcoin being totally private, like Monero, or, you know, on the same way that Liquid, you know, Liquid transaction, man, having Liquid, you know, Liquid network as it is on the base layer, I don't think government was, you know, would accept that. So do you think that it's a compromise that we could make to see Bitcoin, you know, as it is, you know, hard money, have all that, you know, core properties that it has currently, but without privacy?
Yeah, good question, Jerry. A couple things here. So I think that Bitcoin's base layer privacy is probably the weakest thing here. I think when you look out in the world of critics, Bitcoin critics, there's almost no good Bitcoin critics left. they, once you learn enough about Bitcoin in order to critique it, you end up just adopting the system because it makes way more sense. However, the good critics that are left, I would say, are the Monero folks. Even though they're extremely annoying on Twitter, they have a point, which is that Bitcoin privacy sucks, and it does on the base layer. But I think that it's not a question in a vacuum. Like, if we could make Bitcoin privacy better without trading off anything, of course we would say yes to that. But the reality is, I think that the community consensus, and I agree with this, is that the sanctity of the supply, so the ability to guarantee the supply cap has not changed, that is far more important than being able to hide transactions on the base there. And so I think that the setup that we have now is the best setup that we can have given the trade-offs in front of us. What I do hope is we invest a lot on layer two, side chains, layer three, layer four, five, six, whatever Bitcoin's going to turn into in layers. I do hope that we reclaim privacy on those layers. And so that's how I would see that. Now, tying to your point about, like, would a government accept it if it was not private? Or, like, what about the Michael Saylors of the world? Or what about these, like, powerful entities? And how do we approach that as a risk? I agree. I think that the US government and other governments who are meddling in these systems, I think that they prefer the ability to spy on the chain. And that gives them some hope that they might be able to co-opt the system in the future, or at least we're not going to escape without paying their taxes, right? They're going to get their pound of flesh. And I think that that's right. And I think that it's kind of a Trojan horse for Bitcoin, because it seems like it's not as scary as saying this, like, internet cash that nobody can spy on, right? And you're seeing a pushback right now with stable coins. Why? Because stable coins directly compete with US dollar rails, which are spied on now, and stable coins are harder to spy on, just like the euro dollar market or offshore dollars or whatever. And I'd love to bring up an analogy here to wrap up, which is there is a Native American tribe called the Apaches. They were in the southwest of the United States. And as, you know, U.S. colonies started to move west, we sadly genocided the native population all around the continent. And the Apaches were the hardest to stop. Why is that? Because the Apaches form a decentralized hierarchy. They can freely decide which leader they want to go with. Like, maybe I want to go with Ricardo, and then maybe I think Ricardo is weak, so I go with Jerry. And then the group splits or whatever, right? So the US would come in there, they would kill the leader and say, you know, do as we say. And the group would just fracture into two groups. You go kill those two leaders, now you have four groups, right? So they have a decentralized system. They have a protocol that decides where to go. It's kind of like individual nodes choosing which consensus rules to follow, if you want to compare it to Bitcoin. And it took like 100 years, if I'm getting my history right, to stop this Apache group. And what ultimately brought the group down in an ingenious, diabolical way was they decided to give the leader, hey, here's 100 cows or 100 buffalo. In other words, give them wealth. And then they said, leader, now it's your job to distribute this wealth however you see fit to your constituents. And that process of giving them wealth is what broke down the Apache. Turned into a political structure. And it was, you know, how do you figure out who is where? You got to form a committee to give out the buffalo, and the whole system broke, the culture broke. And I say this as a cautionary tale to the fact that we should not allow number go up, or Michael Saylor, or insert any short-term risks that we might see of concentrating supply inside exchanges, or getting in bed with Wall Street or governments or whatever. Essentially, we can't sacrifice our core principles in order to get adoption in the short term, because we will crumble just like the Apache. Instead, we have to be rigid with principles, even if that comes at a high cost. And so, yeah, I just want to frame that up as a cautionary tale to think about this next stage, because I think Bitcoin is now playing bigger and bigger battles with more important bosses. And so the stakes are getting increasingly high, and we need to stay vigilant.
I just got a clap. I love the analogy with the Apaches. It's totally... Man, well done.
Yeah, thanks, Jerry. Man. Good question, man.
That was a good answer for sure, man. I think there's definitely two podcasts worth of stuff in here. Like, if we can have you back in the future, that'd be appreciated. Because I'd like to keep going.
I'd love to.
I'm mumbling a little bit because it's late here, but I definitely would definitely love to have you back. We'll wrap it up because of the time, but yeah, thank you so much, man, for taking the time out of your day to come on and talk with us three delinquents. It was awesome, and it was good to get like a different perspective as well. Like the whole mycelium Bitcoin like link is something that I'd seen that you'd written on, and I'd like skimmed bits, but I hadn't really properly, and then as you said, you explained it pretty much perfectly. Thank you so much for the time. I really appreciate it. And thank you to everyone out there listening as well, who's listening to all of us. It's much appreciated. Hope all of you have an amazing day, week, year, life, whatever it is. And remember to buy Bitcoin.